is to our God. Sing hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Every praise is to our God. Oh, every praise, every word of worship, every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Every praise is to our God. Come on, worship Him. Every praise is to our every word of worship. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Every praise is to our God. Come on, let's praise Him. Every praise is to our every word of worship. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Every praise is to our God. God, my Savior. God, my healer. God, my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. God, my Savior. You're my healer, my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. God, my Savior. He's my healer, my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. God, my God, my Savior, you're my healer, my deliverer. Yes, He is. 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 Every praise. Every word of worship, every prayer, every prayer, every prayer, every prayer is every word of worship, every prayer is to our God. Sing hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah, is to our every praise, every praise, every praise. Come on, every praise, every praise, every praise, every praise. When you see me shouting, every praise. When you see me walking, every praise, every praise. Every praise, every praise, every praise. When you see me walking, every praise. When you see me shouting, every praise, every praise, every praise is to our God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Your name on high. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, I lift your name on high. And I love that song because it deals with the progression. It deals with what he did. He came from heaven to earth. Hallelujah. But when he got to earth, he knew that it wasn't enough. He had to go to the grave, to cross, then to the grave. But that wasn't it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many know that we are here because he rose? Amen. Hallelujah. 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 So what you see standing before you is merely mercy. Hallelujah. Amen. At this time, we have just a dynamic woman of God, and I'm excited to introduce her because I know that the Lord has given her a word, and so I'm excited what the Lord is going to do. Elder Wanda Hosea. I love the women that the Lord has blessed to come. They see in a biography, but some of them just sent like a paragraph or something. They're so humble servants of God, and they just, you know, it's nothing about them. They don't boast about who they are, but it's exciting just to hear what God has done and the call. And I know personally a couple of them that fought against the call, but how God pursued them and how God wooed them and how he wrestled some of them down. And he sent some of them through some things to birth forth this conference. Amen. And then they had to be obedient to the call. Amen. But we digress. So, Elder Wanda Hosea, who would have thought the decision to become a minister was finally made after ignoring the initial call multiple times from the Lord over 20 years ago? Born in Baltimore, Maryland, the youngest of 10 children, Elder Hosea understood the importance of family and community and both being led by God. It's all about the relationships. She believed that ministry, i.e. serving others, happens in and outside of the walls of the church. She is a licensed and ordained minister within the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World and is completing her Master of Divinity degree at Indiana Wesleyan Seminary. Her mantra is, it's never too late to answer the call of God. And we are never too young or too old to learn something new. Amen. Hallelujah. Wanda currently lives here in Bloomington. She has been married to the love of her life, retired Marine Gunnery Sergeant William Hosea, for 14 years. Amen. And together they have 7 children and 10 grandchildren. And a lot of her message and the anointing have come through those 7 children and 10 grandchildren that the Lord has blessed her through it. She currently serves on the ministerial staff at Lighthouse Community Church here in Bloomington, and she leads the Women of Light Ministry, which is leaders inspired to be godly and holy while touching the lives of others. Amen. Please put your hand together and welcome Elder Wanda Hosea.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and I am rejoicing. I am glad in it. Because the Lord just delivered somebody up here today. Hallelujah. For years, I have been trying to get the women to remember that acronym, and she did it today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Women of Light. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm so thankful to be up here. My sister said, you know, the preachers that went before me, they knocked her socks off. And they literally knocked my socks off today. Amen? Amen. But I took my shoes off because after coming from hearing the praise team and hearing these great women of God, it just further reinforced that I am walking on holy ground. This is holy ground. Hallelujah. This is a holy deep place. I don't know about you, but when I first walked into this sanctuary, I was looking around. I said, oh my God, I have never seen anything like this. I've been to a lot of churches, but this was so, as the young people say, this was on fleek. I looked up here. They got scriptures and signs. Talk about signs of the time. Stop sin. Taking it to the streets. And I love because they've got the scriptures that go along with it. And then they're talking about 666, not up in here. Not up in here. And God rules. Keep it right or keep it left. My sister was talking about whose side are you going to be on. You got to pick a side. So are you going left with the goats or right with the sheep? Come on now. Come on. God is good. God is good. And that song, That Every Praise. Now I'm going to give Sister Liz her props today. Because she's been nervous about being the MC. I'm telling on her now. But when she sang that song, I said, you better come on Sunday morning singing like that, girl. You've been holding back. The Lord is delivering today. The Lord has been powerful up in this place. Amen? Amen. Amen. So I have to follow protocol. I'm just going to take 1 minute to make sure that I'm doing things right. Because I always want to honor first my God and my Savior. Amen? Amen. And I want to honor the shepherd of this household, Pastor Larry, and his wife, the First Lady. Always don't ever forget about the women. Amen. Always want to honor our First Lady. Amen. And all the workers, all the family of this house of prayer. We call it the motorcycle church. Amen. Amen. And this is a beautiful place. All the workers, the praise team, everybody. It takes a lot of hard work. Our musicians, everybody. Thank you. Thank you so much, and especially you, because without you, this wouldn't happen. We'd be talking to a lot of empty seats, but don't you know that we'll still preach when nobody's there? Amen. We even got a clown in the audience today. Amen. That's what I'm talking about. So there won't be any clowning around up here. We're going to let them get to their whatever they got to do. Amen. 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 I'm getting situated here. I am excited about the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am excited because I know what he's done for me. Excited about the object of my love. Can nobody take his place? I've got a good guy at home, but he ain't Jesus. Amen. He loves me good, but he can't love me like Jesus. I know somebody said, oh, the wife said, I know that's right. That's right. I know it's right. But nobody can take care of me like Jesus. Amen. And if you don't know Jesus, shoot, I'll just do an altar call right now. And after all that word, I said, they preach my sermon. I don't have to do anything. But if you don't know Christ for yourself, today is your day. That's right. Today is your day. Amen. It's about relationship. Amen. 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 So first, I just want to ask God to bless as I bring his word to his women today. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this privilege and this opportunity to lift up the name of Jesus. And I pray that you use me as a holy vessel so that someone's heart and mind may be transformed and that they accept you as their Lord and Savior. Make you the God of their lives. Amen. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and get started. Angie said, you have like 2 hours to talk. I said, 2 hours? Ooh, make sure lightning don't hit me. She didn't tell me. Okay. I'm not going to take long. And Reverend Candace and Reverend Angie, I mean, they preached a powerful word. And I heard Angie this morning, I said, she preached all my sermon. And then Reverend Candace came up and started preaching my sermon. I said, well, Lord, what do you want me to say? So I'm going to just say what the Lord says. Amen. Thus says the Lord. Amen. Y'all looking beautiful out there. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to throw Reverend Angie Carter under the bus. Somebody said, praise God. Somebody said that. throwing her under the bus, because you know what she did? She first placed me right after lunch. When you're full of the word and you're full of food, and it's hard to keep some folks awake after you've got that combination. You know, it's like, God, you really blessed me. So don't go to sleep on me, all right? So he's challenging me to keep you up during this time, amen? So I know I can't be long. And then the second reason I'm going to throw her under the bus, because she didn't want me to speak. Everybody said, oh. She said, oh. That's why she didn't want me to speak. She wanted a professional, certified public accountant to bring the word of God to talk to you about finances. I said, oh. But she turned her down, obviously. So Reverend Carter needed a ram in the bush. So, you know, I go to her to get my locks done. She hooked me up sometimes. So the one day, the Lord said, go see her. And I didn't have an appointment. He said, just go see her and say hello and see if she needs anything. So I went into the shop, and there she was, and we got to talking. And then all of a sudden, she said, do you think you could do the conference? And I said, in my most spiritual voice, at least this is the way I remember it, I said, let me pray about it. And I'll get back to you. Inside, I was saying, yes, 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 thank you, Lord. But, you know, God does all things well. He does well. And I don't know a lot about, I'm not a CPA, I'm not a public accountant, I'm not an accountant. And I don't know, as you know, an accountant moves large sums of money. I don't know nothing about that. I don't know how to move money. But I do know one thing. And I know God, I know how to serve God, and I know about God's economy. Because that's what makes the difference. Are you with me? Amen, amen. So what I'd like to do today is just share what God told me about finances and spiritual warfare. And he gave me two choices. He said, you can do things in the world's economy, or you can do things in my economy. So I decided to take the highway instead of the highway. Are you with me? Amen. Now, I've been doing a little bit of preaching over the years, and I've been a teacher of the word. I love the word. Anybody else in the house love the word? Oh, just about every hand in the house went up. Love the word. So what I'll do is a little bit of preaching. Okay, a little bit of preaching today. So I want to take some time to share some spiritual things. And if anybody's ever been in my classes, they know we're going to do some practical things. And then whenever God wants to make a change in our life, he gives us a test. So there's a test at the end. Are you ready for the test? You should see your faces. She said, oh my God, what is she going to do? Because my girls, my women of light, they think I'm scary. But I'm not. I'm not scary. No. But they learn, don't they? Y'all learn some things. Amen. So, as my sisters were saying, we're in the book of Isaiah, right? Anybody remember what chapter? Excellent. You're with me. You're listening. You're still awake. You're not too full from the food or the word. Excellent. So, let me give you a little bit of things that happened before Isaiah 54, okay? So Israel was messing up, just like a lot of us do sometimes. They were messing up, and they had turned their back away from God. Amen? And as a result, they were going through some really, really difficult times. Are you with me? Anybody here facing some difficult times? Amen, amen. She had been invaded. She had been invaded by foreign armies, the Babylonians, the Assyrians, the Egyptians, you name them, they were coming after Israel. And what they did was stripped them of their identity, their children, their worship, their religion, which was a way of life, her possessions, and her protection. They took all of that away from Israel because they had turned away from God. Are you with me? Now, God had repeatedly blessed them with land and possessions. He loved Israel, but Israel was taking him for granted. Amen? So instead of possessing the land was possessing them. You got that? They were being possessed. And instead of having peace, they were experiencing conflict and unrest and chaos. And then, instead of protection, as I said, they were being invaded. They were facing some invading. So you know, when so many things are happening to you, and then things are taken away from you, you start to think, because you're getting into a desperate situation, you're starting to think, well, maybe I just need to do something a little bit different. You think? Hello? Because what I'm doing right now is not working. It's not working. So what happened after all this has happened with the Israelites? They had a breakthrough. Can y'all say breakthrough? Breakthrough. Anybody need a breakthrough today? Amen. They had this breakthrough and realized that they needed God. And they began to repent. Now we got to understand, repentance is not doing a 360, because that's, people say repentance is turning around. But it's turning away from that thing that's keeping you from God and turning to God. Amen? Because when you suffer long enough, you're going to do some repenting. Can I get a witness? And they began to listen to Isaiah, that great prophet, about restoring the relationship with God. They began to get their identity back. They began to realize who they were as a people, as women of God. Amen? And God started wooing them back to him. And he opened his arms back to Israel. And in chapter 54, God is expressing his love to his people. Now let me take you there. Now see, their hearts and minds have been changing. But the enemy doesn't want that to happen. He wants to obstruct and block everything, every inheritance that God has for you. You got me? This is warfare. He knows that God is good to his people, whether they're obedient or not. God is good. But when they listen to him, he's especially good. And because they had this breakthrough, God said, I'm going to leave you an inheritance. Now, my sister talked about it a little bit today, but I want you to know exactly what that inheritance is. Amen? Are you with me? Okay. Raise your hand if you want an inheritance. Every hand in the place went up. And the reason I did that, so y'all won't go to sleep on me. Amen. Amen. Now, what's the first thing you think of when somebody gives you an inheritance? Money, land, property, jewelry, furniture, cars. That's the good side of an inheritance. But the flip side of an inheritance is they have a lot of debt and they done left you in trouble. They want you to take care of the responsibility. Sometimes you get some kids, they're good. Sometimes you get some bad kids. But they've left you holding the bag and taking care of responsibility. I've had some inheritance like that. Amen? But God, when God leaves an inheritance, he leaves you with some good things, and it goes beyond that. All right. So let's walk this thing out. Y'all ready to walk with me? So the first thing he does in Isaiah 54:3, it says, he said, as my sister talked about, enlarging your tent, enlarging your space, widening your curtains. Why is he telling him to do that? Because he says, I'm going to bless you to have offspring. Because he first talks about when they were barren. But he says, you're going to have offspring that's going to go from generation to generation, and I'm going to give you the nations. All those places that were barren and the cities that were desolate, he's saying, you're going to populate that. I'm going to give you land and everything that is in it. That's number one. Then we go down to Isaiah 54 and 10, and he talks about Noah. He takes Noah back, and Noah means rest. And he takes them back to the time of Noah, and we know that the flood waters came along. And then God says, I'm going to give you a sign. Anybody know what that sign was? Rainbow. He says, I'm going to give you a sign in the cloud that tells you that you will never experience the flood waters covering the earth today. Now, we've had some hurricanes, some floods in some areas, but the whole earth is not being covered. Is Indiana being covered by flood waters? No way, because God is holding them back. And he says, what I won't do is take away that covenant of peace that I made with Noah. So he left them another inheritance with the covenant of peace. So first he leaves them land. He says, you're going to possess the nations. And then he says, I'm going to leave you a covenant of peace. And then the third thing he talks about in Isaiah 54, 17, and we know that scripture, everybody says, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. But they forget the second part, and my sister, she touched on it. She said that any voice that comes against you in judgment, the Lord shall condemn. Because when you are his faithful children, when you are his faithful women of God, anything that anybody speaks against you, it's going to be cursed. They will be cursed. So he gave them land. He gave them a covenant of peace. And he said, I'm going to give you protection. Those three wonderful things. Isn't God amazing? Now see, in this day, we take it for granted. But God, in giving them that inheritance, he changed some things about them. Because when we receive land, it impacts our financial status. I said, Lord, how am I gonna tie this financial thing in with this spiritual thing and what Isaiah 54 is talking about? And when you receive land, you get assets that go with it. And it's gonna negatively or positively impact your financial status. He left them a covenant of peace. And how many of you know that when you get things, sometimes your peace is taken away because somebody wants a piece of what you got. Amen? Are you still with me? And then he was talking about protection. But now, if we let the enemy come in like the enemy did to Israel, if you let a Babylonian into your life, you're going to be vulnerable. You're not going to be protected. Amen? So, and your finances may be unprotected because you've let somebody who comes in, some of us have been single in our lifetime, and you've let some sweet talker come in and take your money. Or you've let some car dealer tell you that this is the best deal for you, and he's basically taking your money and leaving you with a lot of debt. Amen? Can I get a witness? Anybody ever been there? Amen. Now, you know what? As I'm talking about finances, I'm looking at your faces, and I noticed in the ministry, when we start talking about money, people's faces get real funny. You know? They get real funny, and it's like, I know she's going to ask us to give. Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask you to give, but it's not going to be money. Amen. See, the Bible talks a lot about our finances. It talks a lot about it. And God wants us to know what he's saying and how he does his economy. Amen? So Satan doesn't want us. What's the scripture that says, my people perish for a lack of knowledge? And that knowledge is not only head knowledge. Let me school you. Here comes the teacher. That knowledge is also heart knowledge. It also means that they perish because they don't have a sense of intimacy with me. That relationship. Amen? Amen. So the Bible talks about our finances, and Satan pulls out every weapon. He tells you, now let me see if I got any witnesses in the house. He tells you the preachers in the church are trying to steal your money. Mm-hmm. It's okay. God won't mind if you don't pay your tithes and offering this week. you can make it up. Anybody ever done that? I owe bills. Does God want my car taken away? If I pay my tithes, I can't pay my car payment. I'm a student. I'm poor. I have to pay tuition, plus I don't have a job, so I can't tithe. I can't give. I can't help. I just lost my job. I got to save some money. You need that money for a vacay or a staycay. So I'll give it to you next week, God. Anybody ever been there? Am I the only honest person? I got a sister, two, three. Amen. Well, we're looking for some deliverance today. See, hey, what'd you say? Everybody's hand up? Everybody's wealthy. We're going to talk about that. See, you're giving me confirmation. See, the devil knows how to make us rationalize, and he understands that this is a hard thing. But God says in Matthew 6:21, where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. Now, remember the story about the rich young ruler. Y'all remember that? And he said, Lord, this is in Matthew 19, if you want to go look it up. He said, Lord, what must I do to be saved? And he said, I've obeyed all your commandments since I was a youth. But the Lord put him to the test. And he said, sell all that you have and then come follow me. Now, there's been debate over that, whether he literally meant that, but what he was doing was testing his heart. And the Lord is testing your heart today when it comes to financial matters. And he tested me right before I came up here. He let me win that prize. Before I won it, I told my daughter, I said, okay, if I win, because I didn't think I was going to win. If I win, I'm going to give you whatever I won. Did I pass the test, Domo? Amen. Did I pass it with grace? Kind of. Because it was a gift card, and I didn't want to give it out, but I kept my word. Amen. So he was testing me. He said, you can't preach on that, and you can't pass the test. Amen. So the Bible talks about finances. So here's a teacher thing for you. Did you know that there are approximately 500 verses on prayer? Fewer than 500 verses of scripture on faith, and more than 2,350 verses on money and how to handle it and possessions. See, Jesus understood that we needed money. He understood it takes money to move the gospel. Amen? Now, things were a little bit simpler back there because Jesus didn't have a credit card and he didn't go into debt. Amen? So he didn't have that problem. So let's see what kind of problem you have this morning. Are you ready? Okay. How many of you would like for God to give you some more money? Raise your hand. For those who didn't raise their hand, I'm going to pray for you because I want God to give me some more money because I got some things I could do with it. Amen? How many of us own some land or property, such as a house, a car, a boat, motorcycle, Reverend Angie, anything? How many of us own that? Raise your hand. Both hands up, Reverend Angie. Put your foot up, too, because you got all kinds of stuff. Amen? Anybody own some jewelry? We had a jewelry vendor back there. Got some jewelry, furniture, phone, computer, all that stuff. And how many of us are pretty happy with the stuff that we own? Anybody happy? Yeah, the majority of us are pretty happy. And then the last thing is how many of us have some type of insurance? Health, life, home, got burglar alarm on your car, whatever. But you're insured. So the point that I'm making, I talked about inheritance of land, the covenant of peace, and security, right? Protection. And seems like the majority of us in here have that inheritance from God. Would you agree with me? Just by the show of hands, you've got all those things from God. But here's the kicker. Like the Israelites, we want more. We want more money, land, and riches. Like the Israelites, we got stuff. Not just material stuff. We got some stuff going on in here and in here. And then most of us, like the Israelites, have had to travel in and out of some lands, forcibly or not. You've traveled. And if we're like the rich young ruler, we're putting some things first before Christ. So let me tell you what God gave me. He says it's not about what you possess. It's about what possesses you. It's not about what you possess, but what is it in your life besides the material, financial things that are possessing you? Here's the struggle. Our possessions can compete with Jesus Christ to be first in our lives. Who's first in your life right now? How we handle money impacts our relationship with Christ. And again, a large part of our lives revolve around money. Let me share something with you real quick, and I'm almost done. I remember Angie had asked me about 3 or 4 years ago. She said, how did you do it? I said, do what? She said, how did you make it? How did you get into the position that you're in now? Because see, I was married, and I got divorced, and I had 2 babies. And I was here in Indiana with no family. And I had no job. I had nothing. My family was way back there in Baltimore. My dad had died. It was just my mom, and she was on fixed income. And I was getting like maybe $50 a month in child support. And that's not a lot of money for 2 kids. And God blessed me with a job. And then he sent me to this little storefront church on 6th and Adams in Bloomington, and I began to hear the word of the God that taught me, this man taught me about God's economy and way of doing things. And then I learned about Malachi 3:10. He says, test me. Because girlfriend said this morning, I want to know the God who parted the Red Sea. So he said, test me and watch me pour out some blessings so big that you can't grab a hold of. So I said, okay, Lord, here I was, single parent, just got a job, just got a car, which wasn't working all the time. And he said to give. I'm like, give goes back to you pay your tithes or do you pay the car payment? And we, again, she talked about discernment. We got to be discerning. So he tested me, and I started putting my little bit of money in church. Next thing I know, I start getting promotions. And then instead of that spending that promotion money, I started banking it. And whatever bills I had, here's the practical part. I put that money that I got on my promotions and put it toward my bills. And the next thing I know, I'm out of debt. Amen. God is great, isn't he? Yeah. Good, y'all clapping? Well, guess what? I started doing like this. We're like turning my back. Next thing I know, I'm charging up cards, doing the same thing I did before. And I'm back in debt again. So what I do? Oh, Lord, help me. I'm testing you. Help me, Lord. So I go back painfully and do the same thing again. I get out of debt a second time. Ain't that good? Anybody been in debt? Know what it feels like, and it's hard to get out of it. So, okay, it's working good. I'm learning from the man of God. Things are getting better. Guess what, y'all? 3 times is a charm, and I ain't talking about the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, which is one anyway. So I'm doing the same thing, and I find myself right back in debt again. What was wrong? Anybody had that experience? What's wrong? Why didn't it change? I said, Lord, what is it? So he said, you need a heart change. You need a renewal of the mind. So I said, I thought I understood your kingdom. I thought I was giving. I was doing everything I was supposed to do, but I found myself right back in the same place again. So here's what he tells me. He says he wants us to understand something about our attitude toward finances. That attitude. An attitude is nothing but your thought life turned inside out. There is a difference between wealth and riches. There's a difference. Wealth is who you are. Riches is something you have. Wealth is who you are. And it's always an inward realization. When I realized that God loved me and that he cared about me, that thing began to manifest. No longer would I let the enemy come in and invade me because I knew who I was. And it took me a little while to get there, but I found out who I was in God as a woman of God. Amen? Wealth includes our creativeness and our spiritual knowledge and ideas and character. And it's achieved through our skill sets and obedience. Amen? Wealth can produce riches, but riches cannot produce wealth. And it comes from being obedient to God's covenant. What's your relationship with God right now? Ask yourself. This is a heart-searching moment. What's your relationship? When you focus on attaining riches, you will not have peace. When you're always coveting or always asking people for stuff, you will not have peace. Peace. Peace is prosperity, entirety, nothing missing, nothing broken. It's assurance, alliance with God, and it's awareness of God. It's completeness and contentment, and it's ease. You'll go through some things, and it won't seem difficult. People ask you, how'd you go through that? But God will make it easy for you, amen? So if you want peace, anybody in the house besides me, always want peace. Amen. Amen? Then do what Matthew 6:33 says. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, his right way of doing things, his right way of economy, and all those other riches and things will be given to you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now I'm going to do one more thing. We got some stuff going on in the world today, right?
Yes.
I'm getting ready to close. And I said, God, do you really want me to do this? Here comes the test. There's a lot of things going on in the world. And Satan wants to steal your joy. He wants to mess up your finances. Because I'll bet if the majority of you said you were getting laid off from your job in the next 2 weeks, you couldn't make it through the next 6 months. Am I lying or am I flying? I ain't doing either one. Amen? If something happened and you were in an accident and you couldn't work, we couldn't make it for the next 6 weeks. And you know what's sad to God? And he puts it in his word. He says that the wicked, the people in the world, know how to handle their finances better than my people do. That's sad. And we should be like the people in the Bible, especially the disciples in the book of Acts, when they gathered together in one heart and one mind, and they pooled all their resources and helped one another. And as women of God who are looking for release, that's what we need to do. So there is hope. And this is what I'm going to ask us to do. I've been on this 40-day prayer challenge, and I finished the first 40 days, and now I'm going back through it again with my husband, who is not a churchgoer, but we get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and I read the challenge, each challenge to him. There's a challenge a day. And in one of the challenges, it talks about prayer. And the pastor who wrote the book, he said that when he wrote this 40-day prayer challenge, that the Lord gave him 2 Chronicles 7:14. And his church had been praying that scripture every day at the same time at 7:14 in the morning. But one day he had to go to Ohio and fly out, and he was going to miss his time of prayer. So he was talking to the Lord about it. He said, what can I do? So the Lord says, I want you to pray at gate D8 right in the middle of the airport. And he's like, that must be from God, because God wouldn't ask me to do that. But he said, okay, I can pray after I go to baggage claim. I can pray after I get to my hotel. And he said, no, I want you to do it now. He says, I want you to get on your knees at gate D8 and pray. Now, how would you feel if the Lord told you to do that? Could you pray with all these people around in the middle of the airport and get on your knees and pray? We got some people who said, yeah. So I'm thank you, Lord. You are confirming. So I stopped by Sister Angie's place the other day, and I was telling her the story, and I said, can we pray? I said, can we get on our knees and pray? So we stopped in the shop. Nobody, God kept it, so it was just us. And she said, you know what? I haven't been on my knees for a long time. She hasn't assumed that posture prayer for a long time. So her and her old creaky self, she got down. She was like, help me, Lord, help me. I'm loving you, Angie, I'm loving you. And we got down on there, and some things were broken. Some deliverance took place in that shop. So the Lord said, ask the women who are here, if they would get on their knees, they can come to the altar. This is our altar call. If you can get on your knees where you are or come to the altar and empty out your heart, because God, this is a heart thing. And he's saying, if you can do that, then you want some breakthroughs, not only in the financial area. And some of you have had some breakthroughs this morning. But he said, not just in your financial. And there's plenty of books and tools out there. I can recommend some. I can help you in that area, because the Lord has blessed us. Between me and my husband, in the past 14 years, we've owned 9 homes. 9 homes, and I'm not bragging, because it is God. And he blessed us to be debt-free because we're following God's economy, even though he doesn't go to church. But he listens to me when it comes to God's way of doing things. And I'm not saying that, okay, if you do this, God will do this. What he's saying is he wants his heart, your heart. So if anybody is willing, because I'm going to get down on my knees and pray us out. If anybody is willing to come to the altar or pray on in your seats, if you can't get on your knees, then pray in your heart. But I'm asking, if you want a breakthrough today, if you want a breakthrough for whatever is holding you in debt and bondage, come and join me in one accord. Girlfriend Candace said, we can't blame everything on the devil. Our back hurts. My knees hurt, but Sister Angie got down on her knees anyway. Some of us in a wheelchair, we can't bend. We can't do it. But if you're at your seat, I want you to pray. Don't be a distraction. Satan is distracting enough as it is. Amen? We don't want that. And we don't want to give credit to him in the house of God. Amen? So I'm just going to do a closing prayer. As we lift up our hearts and we assume a posture of being humble in God's house. Lord, you're just blessing right now. Heavenly Father, the sister came up and prayed for me earlier. And she said, be sensitive to the voice of God. So I said, Lord, I don't care if I look like a fool no matter where I am. Whatever you tell me to do, I'm going to do. So Father, as we close, I'm going to read this scripture to you, and then I'm going to get on my knees with you and pray. In 1 Chronicles 7:14, it says, if my people, my women of God, the women of God who walk not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor do these women of God stand in the way of the sinner, nor do they sit in the congregation of the unrighteous. For the Lord says, you women of God are like trees planted by the river of water, whose leaf shall not wither, who shall bear fruit in its season, and everything that you do shall prosper. Because you meditate on the word of the Lord day and night, and you want your hearts to be pure, to be open, to be sensitive to the Lord. And he says, if my people are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, not my hand, but my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Heal their land and everything that is in it. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, as we stand here, as we're kneeling, as we're sitting in this sanctuary and holy ground, hallelujah, Father, we just want to thank you. So many women are going through so many things, Lord, and we feel like we have to put on a face to the world when we're actually not having any peace because we don't own the things that you said that we could have. So many of us are going into credit card debt. So many of us, as my sister said earlier, are in the store spending money that they don't have. So many people are just putting on a farce and trying to keep up with the Joneses, Lord. But we're saying today, we want to let that go. We want to be authentic. We want to be real with you, Lord. We want to experience the fullness of the Lord and your true inheritance. And that's a heart that's turned to you, Lord. Take away anything that is not pleasing to you. Those who have closets full of stuff, and then there are some who have none. Let us be like the apostles, the disciples in the book of Acts, where they came together and those who were in need that they gave, those who have an abundance of food, abundance of cars and everything else, things that we don't need and yet we go out and buy more. And I'm talking about me too, Lord. Let us have a heart that wants to give. Father, let us have a heart that keeps you first before any possessions. Thank you, Lord, as they sang in that song today, that you came from heaven to earth to show us the way. And in your word, over 3,250 times, you have given us scripture that directs us what to do. If only we would hear and obey. And as we are now, Lord, we are humbling ourselves before you. So, Father, with that, we thank you for the hope that you have given us. We are like those Israelite people who turned their back on you. But, Lord, we are turning to you and seeking your face. And, Lord, thank you for the hope in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the love that you have given us, Lord, the unconditional love. Even when we go three times after you've told us what to do and we find ourselves right back in the same old stupid situation, but yet you love us. So, Father, anything that is not pleasing to you, the way that we're living, the way that we're keeping our homes, the way that we're keeping ourselves, the way that we're managing our finances, the way that we're treating people, the way that we're serving you with indifference sometimes, the way that we're being rebellious to those who are in authority to us. Father, we give it all to you, and we right now thank you, and we praise you. Every praise is to our Lord. Every word of worship is to our God. Those songs were not coincidence, Lord. You're speaking to our hearts right now, and we thank you. We thank you for the inheritance. We thank you for what you left the Israelites and what you're leaving us today. We thank you. And we give you every praise from our lips and in our actions and in our love. And with that, Lord, we say thank you and we bless you. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Now, when we go out of this door, Lord, we will not speak negative words. We will think on those things that are good and lovely and pure and of good report. We will praise your name and we will come to you for wisdom. We will look at your way of doing things. And we bless you in the wonderful, majestic name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And let the women of God say amen. 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 Let's give God some praise. Let's give God some praise. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you all so much. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless God. Thanking God for that word. Amen. We serve a practical God that challenges us to do things that we would not ordinarily do. But the power that was in this room as women bowed not only their hearts but their knees before the Almighty God. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but when she first said it, I said, But then as I got down on my knees and I heard my sister beside me just crying out to the Lord, I was like, thank you, Lord. Because sometimes when we are setting up or sometimes when we're pacing or walking around the church, we not necessarily hear the cries of one another. But there's an intimacy when you're bowed before you on your knees alongside of your sister. There's an intimacy that takes place. Amen. Hallelujah. So thank you, Minister Hosea, for being obedient to the word of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Man. These sisters in red are some hardworking sisters. Amen. And beautiful inside and out. We came last week, the first time we had the opportunity to meet them. And I mean, we were here making bags on an evening, and they had so much joy to work. I was like, Lord, now that's a lot of joy. And they were all excited. And they were excited about the opportunity to serve God's people. And so I bless God for each of them and the love that they have poured out. Have you felt love today? Amen. See, and that's what God does. He just reminds us that you are special to me and I love you. And so every now and then he'll take his servants and say, I just want to show you a little extra love to let you know that I have not forgotten you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So at this time, we are going to have a praise dance by two just wonderful women of God, Reverend Mindy May and Reverend Angela Carter's, her own baby, Aaron Carter. And I look at Aaron, I'm like, I knew her before she was born. And to see the beautiful woman that she has allowed God to allow her to grow into, I'm so excited. And I'm so excited that this is only the beginning of what God has for you. Amen. Because he has so much more in store for you as you yield to him. Do not despise the days of your youth. Amen. Because he has a call on your life. Amen. So please welcome this and them at this time as they will do this beautiful praise worship.
Yeah.
As the praise team come back up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I'm excited to know that the battle is not mine. Because I fought for many years thinking the battle was mine and losing on every turn. But the battle is not mine. It's the Lord. Hallelujah. And I don't know about you, but I was looking at the faces of the dancers, and I was convinced that they understood that the battle was not theirs. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Freedom, 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 fre What God has for me,
yes.
It is for me.
Yes, 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 yes.
What God has for me, it is for me. I know without a doubt,
hey, glory,
that He will bring me out. What God has for me, it is for me.
We're gonna sing that again.
What God has for me,
it is
for me. Bring us all out.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What God has for me, it is for me.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. You are so awesome.
Thank you, Jesus.
So good. Oh my gosh. Got my mama here. She's been so sick. Oh, hallelujah. My mama.
Hallelujah. He could have kept on with that song of worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What God has for me. How many know that whatever God declares for me, no devil in hell can stop it? Hallelujah. No sickness, no disease, no famine, no disappointment. What God has for me, it is for me. Hallelujah. And in order for it to be for me, that means He knows me by name.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Because each of you know that God has something tailor-made for you. Not for nobody else in your family, not for your neighbor. Amen. So that means that God knows you intimately, who you are. He told us in His word that He did, that He knows the very numbers of hairs that's on our head. So whatever God has for us, it is for us. Hallelujah. Amen. And I look and I see Dondre get excited when and got teary when he was talking about his mother. And I remember the night when Angie called me and said, I think my mother's leaving here. And she asked, will you go in prayer? And we were going into prayer that night. And we said, Lord, allow your will to be done. Whatever your will is, we don't understand it. But if it's your will for her to go home, then let it be. But if it's her, your will for her to be here, and here she sits today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, God wasn't through. Because what he has for Miss Sharon, it is. It shall come to pass, and she ain't going away until he says so. And she's all right with that. Because she's a child of the Most High God. Amen. So I just want to encourage you, don't fear, people of God. When we see the calamities that's going on, don't fear. Because everything that God has declared for us shall come to pass. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to have an opportunity to introduce a wonderful woman that I had the opportunity to meet this morning. And you know how sometimes when you just meet somebody and you don't know them, but you meet them and but they have that like spirit, and you can feel that spirit where you're like, okay. So when I met them, this morning, I was like, that's that like spirit. I like that. So Reverend Sharonda Ely, she's a native and current resident of Louisville, Kentucky, and the mother of four beautiful children and four grandchildren. Reverend Ely has been in ministry for over 30 years. Amen. And she is an ordained elder in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Reverend Ely currently ministers at Bethel AME Church in New Albany, Indiana, where she has been for 8 years. Above all, she loves the Lord, and she loves his word and aspires to please him. That's her heart's desire, is to please him. Are you behind me for a reason? I guess I'm going to finish introducing him, and then he's going to see. See, one of the things that Minister Hosea taught me some years ago was to improvise, adapt, and overcome. So we're going to do that. But I'm going to go ahead and finish introducing Reverend Ely. Reverend Ely have a saying that she lives by. And when I got this, I was like, how powerful is that? And the saying is, there is no greater force for good anywhere than the love of God in the hearts of the believer. Amen. And so at this time, we're going to have Dondre with a song of worship, and the next voice you will hear following him will be Reverend Rolanda Ely, Sharonda Ely. Please forgive me.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. This song is for my mom. He lived and died.
her still. This come assurance this child can face uncertain days because he
hallelujah. You know, it's something about coming to a place and you don't know nobody. Hey, hey, man, I know a couple of folks, but that's about it. But I thank and praise God, amen, always to come into the house of God. Yeah. Amen, and walk in and feel the presence of God. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Feel the presence of God and to meet some new saints. Amen. Yeah. So it's really good, amen, to be here. And I thank and praise God for that privilege. Thanking again. Reverend Carter, amen, special young lady. I'm trying to catch my breath, you guys, give me a minute. Very special young lady, young preacher. My pleasure to hear her, amen. She came down to Bethel, and spoke a word of the Lord for us, amen, and blessed our hearts. And so I just thank and praise God for her and for this opportunity. I ask you pray for me, amen. I have not eaten anything, amen. But I did drink some coffee. I've got those coffee jitters, amen, sitting on an empty stomach. But the Lord is still good, amen. And amen, I'm here to tell you that there is a word for the Lord, from the Lord for you today. Amen. The women who have come before me have done an outstanding job, amen, and have just blessed my soul, amen. There's one thing about being a leader, spiritual leaders, is that we pour out a great deal, and we don't always get poured into a lot. And so I thank and praise God that he put me at the end of this, amen, so that I can sit back and get poured into for a little while, amen, and minister to. Each one of those women spoke to something in my heart. And so I just thank and praise God, amen, for this Holy Ghost setup. Hallelujah. Amen. Fighting is what we're talking about today out of Isaiah. And as I was asking the Lord what it was that he wanted me to say and what he wanted me to do, he took me over to 1 Corinthians. Amen. So I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles, and I'm going to remember to hold this mic up. Open your Bibles if you would to 1 Corinthians. The 9th chapter, 1 Corinthians 9, amen. 1 Corinthians 9, and we're going to begin. Let me see where I want to start here. Let's go. Yeah, let's pick up at verse 24. And then we're going to read down to verse 27. It's 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 27. Now, don't look at me like that, because I understand that the scripture text was in Isaiah, the 54th chapter, and I told the Lord that. I said, well, Lord, now, Lord, you know the text is in Isaiah. So not only is this not on the text, it's not even in the same testament. I mean, we have crossed a great divide here, Lord. But the songster said it right. Well, God has for you. Amen. It is for you. Amen. The word of God reads on this wise, beginning with the 24th verse. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainty, certainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be cast away. Amen. Our thought for today, for just a few moments, is this my fight? If the problem, I'm sorry. There's a man by the name of S.W. Van Trump, no relation, I don't think, tells this story of a young man who struggled terribly with a bad temper, erupting into constant fights with his fellows. This destructive activity continued until a visiting speaker at his school said these words. In a brief speech, he told the boys that he had once been a Union soldier and had fought in the battles of his country. He told of the courage it required to face death upon the battlefield. He described the charges his company had made and met, the sieges, the marches, the sufferings they endured, and lastly, the joys that victory and the end of the conflict brought. Then when the boys were at the height of their interest and expectancy, he skillfully drew the lesson he wanted them to learn. He told of a greater warfare, requiring a higher courage and bringing as a reward larger and more enduring victory. Boys, he said, the real soldiers are the Christian soldiers. The real battle is the battle against sin. The real battleground is where that silent struggle is constantly waging within our own minds. Sometimes it needs but one small breach to begin to overthrow a giant wall. One small key, if it's the right one, will open the most resistant door. One small phrase may start the germination of a thought growing in a human mind, which in after years may become a mighty oak of character. Right now, we are going to explore that thought by asking ourselves one question. Is this my fight? Pray with me, will you? Father God, in the name of Jesus, again, we bless and we praise you, oh God, as we come before you. Lord God, we sit at the edge of our seats, oh God, with expectation, Father God, that you will sow into us, Lord God, your heavenly seed, Lord God, that Father God, in due season, Lord God, that seed will take root deep within the hearts of these, your people, Lord God, Father, and begin to bless the world. In the name of Jesus, oh God, we bless you. Father, we ask that let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, Lord God, be acceptable in thy sight, oh Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And the church said, Fighting is what I have done most all my life. I was the victim of abuse as a kid from my earliest rememberings. I don't remember a time when that was not the case. And so I've always been a fighter, not always been a conqueror, not always waged good warfare, didn't always win every battle, but I've always been a fighter. And I was always a fighter for one reason and one reason alone, that somewhere past the pain, past the torment that was my childhood, somewhere I knew that there was a God who loved me. And that if I could just hold on through the pain, if I could just make it past this struggle, if I could just wait long enough, God would bring me out. And so spiritual warfare for me is not a new thing. But I've learned, and God has taught me many things within that journey. Right now, spiritual warfare is a natural part of the Christian life. You guys mind if I take my shoes off? I was so happy. I tell you, I'm from Kentucky. So we do this stuff down there all the time. Hey, amen. I didn't know y'all did it in Indiana. So when I saw the speakers up here with no shoes, I was like, oh, yes. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Spiritual warfare is a natural part of a Christian's life. Thank you. Thank you so much. Even if, I think I got one here. Even if we ourselves are not engaged in the fight, battles are going on around us all the time. Whether we are at work, there are battles. Whether we are at home, there are battles. Whether we are out and about engaging in the daily things of daily things, there are battles that are all around us. You can always count on the fact that sometimes, somewhere, somebody is causing trouble. Job 14:1 says, man that is born a woman is few of days and full of trouble. So as Christians, it is unnecessary for us to go out looking for a fight. Left to itself, the fight will invariably find us. There was a movie that came out in 1970 called Cromwell. one of the characters gives this quote: every man who wages war believes that God is on his side. I'll warrant that God should often wonder who is on his side. Man's war is a nasty piece of business, and truth be told, the glories of war do not come anywhere close to the tragedies of war. Spiritual warfare is not much different in those regards. I would surmise that we have more tragedies during spiritual warfare than we do have victories. A great degree of our spiritual wounded are made so by a friendly fire. We can talk about technique, armor, and environment. But given the weightiness of our fighting of spiritual battles, it behooves us to ask the question first: is this my fight? This is a loaded question. And it's loaded because although it seems to require a yes or no answer, either reply carries with it its own arsenal of responses. This would seem to be a two-option response, but it is not. This is a three-part answer in the form of three poignant questions. The first is this my fight? Yes or no? The second is, where is my struggle? And the third is, who is my enemy? Like I said, when I grew up knowing where my enemy was, or at least I thought I did. As a kid of three, my earliest memories go back that far, I thought I knew what the problem was and who the problem was, but I didn't. And I wouldn't find out until God had grown me up a little bit and began to show me where the real struggle was and where my real enemy was, and then taught me then how to confront that struggle and how to confront that enemy. We are losing folk in the church every day. We have lost entire generations in the church. They're not there. Where are your teenagers? Where are your young adults? We'll lose them in the church, and they are being injured, not by the word. They're being injured by Christians who don't know how to handle the word correctly. Who don't know where the real battlefield is. Who, when they see young people coming in with their pants around their ankles and purple and blue and black hair and on one head, think that they know what the problem is and begin to fight on a battlefield when there is no battlefield there. And the end result is that we have isolated and injured an entire group of people. We have folk now who are questioning how they were made when they were born. And it is the job of the church not to criticize and not to condemn, but to love them into wholeness. But too many times the church isolates them, makes them feel different, makes them feel less than. And they can't sing that song. What God has for me is for me. These three things must be answered in any conflict. You must know who your enemy is. You must know the nature of your struggle, and you must determine the cost of the fight. The Father has gathered us here today to answer those questions, because some of you today have been in a struggle literally of a lifetime. There are parts of your walk that you have been trying your entire life to get victory over. Some of you, of fear has halted your progress, and you cannot advance or press against the very thing because you're pressing against the very thing that you're producing. Let me say that again. For some of you, fear has halted your progress, and you cannot advance because you're pressing against the very thing that you're producing. Some of you, it's as simple as this. Violence has been a constant companion. And even when it is not in the house, it has always been in the neighborhood. And so God has a word for you today about whether or not this is your fight. We're going to take those options in reverse order. So we're first going to look at who is my enemy. Have you ever struck out in fear and anger against someone only to find out later that it was the wrong person? Or even better, that the reason your fight never, that the reason for your fight never existed to begin with. Ever been there? See, we enjoy the praise and worship. Amen, because it makes us feel good. Breaks up that fallow ground that we've been dealing with through the week when we've got to deal with the world. And so we like that. But we kind of shy back when it comes to the Word of God. Because the Word of God penetrates. But there are some of you that God has ordained victories in your life. There are some of you that God has spoken an overcoming in your life, and that overcoming was meant to be for today. And the women who have spoken the word of God into your life have planted seeds of overcoming and victory in your life today. And the praise and the worship was meant only to soften up that ground enough that when God planted those seeds of victory, that it was able to find that good dirt of the heart, that it, in its own season, would be able to produce much fruit to his glory. How many of you want that? How many of you want to be used by the Lord? How many of you want to be significant? It is a shame for us as human beings, particularly as Christians, for us to have gone through the whole world, through our entire lives, and not made a difference in one person's life. Who is my enemy? Given the lethalness of our eternal armament, it is imperative that we know who our true enemy is. Only then can we make sure that we are on the right battlefield. Where is my battlefield? If my enemy is outside of me, someone or something coming against my good, that's my enemy, then my battlefield is the spiritual environment around that person or thing. Let me explain this. If my enemy is outside of me, it's not me. It's outside of me. If out there is where my enemy is, and that's not usually the case, usually the problem is you and me. But sometimes it is outside of us. But if he or she or it is my enemy, then the way that I address that battlefield is that I must speak into the spiritual environment surrounding that person or that thing. The Bible tells us that Jesus told a story about the wheat and the tare. And when they asked the question, should we go ahead and just go ahead and pluck up the tares? Because we see the tares. Can we go ahead and get them out of the way of the wheat? And God said, no, I don't want you to do that, because I need you to let the wheat and the tare grow up together. And then we'll take care of everything at the end of the age. Why does God do that? Why? Because what starts out as a tear in the church could very well become wheat. That's why we invite sinners to come to church. That's why we look for those who are lost and searching, those who don't have it all together. Those who are stumbling through life and through that society is thrown away. That's why we reach out to them. Why? Because their tares about to be wheat. And we as the church, as the living hands and voice and eyes of God, we as the church must be willing to love them enough to embrace them. Love them enough to hold on to them. Because sometimes it's proximity based. And if you can get God close enough and hold him there long enough, it's enough for God to start to crack, crack, crack. But holding them there is going to cost you something. Because they'll fight you, they will cuss you, they will do everything they can to get away from you. But if you hold on with the love of God long enough, it's impossible to be that close to God and nothing change. It's impossible. You can't be that close and nothing changed. Where's my battlefield? In the case of a person, I fight not to destroy the person, only the influences on them. Hear me? We don't destroy people. We love people. But you have it within you. God has put it within you that you have the ability to begin to speak and undo some things in them. God says that we are to go out and set the captives free. Remember that? This is how we do that. We go into places that you wouldn't normally go. And I've never been to the house of prayer. Not this one. So I'm not really sure what you all do or what you don't do. But there is absolutely no place on the planet where Christians can't go. None. Not one. God told me one time, this is probably my last time here. But I'm going to tell you. God told me one time, he said, I want you to get up. I want you to go down to that business down the street on the corner. And I said, what, the bar? And he said, yes, I want you to go out to the bar. And I said, well, Lord, what do you want me to do in the bar? He said, just do what I said. Just go down. Did God talk to you guys like this? Yeah. Thank you. I don't feel so bad. He said, don't just go down to the bar. And so I did. And I went in there, and I didn't drink then. I was younger then, but I didn't drink then. And I said, well, Lord, what do you want me to do? He said, I want you to order a Coke and just sit there. And I set a table in the middle of the room. I ordered a Coke, and I just sat there. And he said, watch this. And all of a sudden, the Spirit of God fell in that place. And I kid you not, I'm not kidding. I watched God. As heads started turning, people started fidgeting. People started looking. And he told me, sometimes it's not, I don't send you places for you to do anything. I send you places because then it gives me legal access to do anything I want to do. But that means we've got to be willing to get mud on our nice suits. We got to be willing to sweat out a nice do. We got to be willing to let God mess us up. If in messing us up, he sets somebody else free. Amen? Amen. In Isaiah, the 42nd chapter, the 3rd verse, it reads this way, and I'm not going to hold you long. I'm going to hurry and get through. I'm going to stop editorializing. Amen. In Isaiah 42, verse 3, it says, a bruised reed shall he not break, and a smoking flax shall he not quench. He shall bring for judgment unto truth. Jesus does not ignore the spiritually wounded, but he will deal with the wounded before he deals with the man. What if the enemy is me? Preacher, I mean, if you look back over your life and find that though situations and environments in your life have changed, you have still struggling with some of the same problems, some of the same troubles, some of the same struggles, regardless of the changes in your life. Well, then the problem is probably not outside of you. The problem probably is you. If you are the only common denominator in all your conflicts. Yeah, it's you. Yeah, it's you. None of us are immune to this enemy. Even the Apostle Peter had his own little evil mini-me to contend with. You remember the story when in Matthew 16, he says, Jesus was talking to him. This is right after he had done the who do men say that I am? And Peter, thou art the Christ, Son of the living God. Oh, good job, Peter. Flesh and blood didn't show you that. That was my Father from heaven. He did that. Good job, Peter. And he turns right around. And as Jesus is talking about some things that was going to have to happen to him, and Peter rebuked him. Say, Lord, you're not Lord. We're not going to have none of that. Because Peter was a fighter. Peter was a warrior. He just didn't know how to fight right. But the text picks up and he says, and I say unto thee, Peter, this is Jesus, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I'll give you unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever thou shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he charged his disciples that they should not tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. And from that time forth, Jesus began to show unto his disciples how he must go into Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed and raised again on the third day. And Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee. But he turned, this is Jesus, and said to Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Peter couldn't catch a break. He had just scored a winning touchdown for the Lord. Yes, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then he turns around and thinks that he could rebuke the Lord. And Jesus turned around. Remember, that's what he said. And he turned, which means Peter was behind him talking that. Yeah. And Jesus turned. You ever had somebody turn on you? Anybody got teenagers? And you done told them something, and while you walking away, and you just, I just know you didn't just say something. And that was, get thee behind me, Satan. Why? Because the problem wasn't with Peter. The problem was what was influencing Peter. Get thee behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me. But Peter had to reassess. Amen. Now I'm not all that I thought I was. Maybe I don't know everything that I thought I knew. Maybe I just need to sit back and learn some more stuff at the feet of Jesus, because I've gone off track here. And when God rebukes you, when God turns to you and he scolds you, don't think of that as this old poor pitiful me and going to this pity party. You need to be blessing and praising God all the more that God would take the time out of his service to come to you and to begin to want you to be a better person, to be a better man, be a better woman, to be the one, the vessel that he has planned for you to be, a vessel that you don't even know what this looks like. I'm going to go on. Yeah, preachers, you have to put us on a time clock. Amen. I'm not even kidding. Amen. I started a Bible study once in a beautician shop. Amen. I started a Bible study once in a beautician shop, lasted 5 hours. I'm not even kidding. It was great. I loved it. If I'm the enemy, then it behooves me to know what part of me is actually the problem. Now listen to this. My heart, my soul, or my body. We, like our Jewish brethren of old, construct elaborate ordinances to distinguish the fact that we are our own worst enemy. The answer is this. If flesh is the problem, then the answer is physical. If the source of my struggle or stumble is outside of me, then the answer is to change the environment to conquer the sin. Example, if you have a problem with gossiping, but the only time you gossip is when you're around a certain group of women. You okay? You don't talk about nobody. You're good. You're good natured. I mean, look, you got a beautiful heart for the Lord, but the only time you start to gossip, I'm sorry, is this too close? The only time you start to gossip is when you're around these other women. Then God says, cut them off. Cut them off before what's around you starts to get in you. That requires that we leave some folk behind. Some folk that might be near and dear to us, that might love us, and we might love them, But when they become toxic to us, and a choice must be made, then the choice we make is Jesus. If the Bible says in Mark 9:47, if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. This seems to be the easiest answer, but it's not always. If, however, my enemy is inside of me, meaning I wake up and lie down with this joker every day, then changing my environment does nothing in defeating this enemy. If the location of my transgression is in my spirit, then it is all about what we are allowing to influence or entertain us. Listen, time and time again, Jesus warned his disciples not to be like the Pharisee and the Sadducees. In other words, he did not want them to allow the religious leaders of their day to influence their walk with God the Father. Likewise, in the Old Testament, God the Father warned the children of Israel not to hook up with the nations that were currently living in the places that God was giving to them. In other words, the Lord was telling them to limit their influences and not to allow just anyone or anything to make intimate impressions in their spirit. If the problem is a part of you, it has in fact become a part of your, and has in fact become a part of your personality, it is then a soulish problem. Soul problems are not about influences, neither are they environmental. These problems are latent holdovers from your pre-redeemed state. Romans 8:7 says, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it cannot be subject to the law of God, neither indeed can it be. And James 4:4 says, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whoso therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. And God answers to the soul problem of carnality is given in Romans 6:6. And he says this, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. This battlefield is fought in only one place, the ethereal and holy presence of God himself. If the problem is a soul problem, if a problem has become a part of who you are, then the only way for you to address that and the only place for God to fix that is in his presence. You can't sing your way through it. You can't read your way through it. You're going to have a head-to-head with the God of the universe and fall down on your knees in complete submission and say, God, I need you to fix this. Because if you don't fix it, it can't get fixed. Some of you who have been fighting these lifetime battles have been fighting them because you don't know how to defeat them. You've been thinking that they were outside of you. You've been thinking that they were what was around you. You've been thinking that they were things that were influencing you. And all the time, the problem has simply been you, inside of you, the you that you don't want to see. The you that God goes through painstaking effort to show you. You ever had God set you up? And I don't mean set you up for a victory. I mean set you up to show you you. Because there's some things in you that may not surface in you until you're in the right situation for it to come out. But God knows it's there. And you need to know it's there. And if God gets you to the point where he's showing you you, then he's also got you to the point where he says, we can fix this thing right now. Amen. This isn't a future delivery. This is a present delivery. And I say that because some people are here today who God has a deliverance call on their life. And you have started that here. God has already moved on you here for that deliverance. But you need to understand who's doing the fighting, who the enemy is, and where the battlefield is. Because if I come to God, even having been sung myself happy, and I fall before him, or I come and I want the saints to pray for me, and I got my hand, well, and I get slain in the spirit. All of that is good, but only if you understand what it is God is trying to do in your life. There's some folk, when God slays you, you'll stay there for hours. Because he's trying to work something out in you. And he will take the time to help you to confront it in the most loving place. Look, I told you how I started. I'm not even going to finish. I told you how I started. Amen. I'm really going to finish. I told you how I started my life as a kid. And I've got four beautiful grandchildren. And I look at them and I think, wow, look at these beautiful, innocent kids. And I was like, wow, what could I have been if I had been able to have that kind of innocence? If I had not been so wounded as a kid, what could God have done with me if that had happened? And I started to lament and mourn my lost childhood and my daughter. She came to me, she said, Mom, what's going on? And I told her, and she said, but Mom, let me ask you this. If God hadn't delivered you from all that you had gone through, would you be the person that you are right now? Would you know the things that you know? Would you have this deep set, overwhelming love of God that bubbles up out of your belly? Would that be there if God hadn't been the deliverer, that if you hadn't had the wounds? Sometimes we've got to have enough courage to take the wounds, yes. To let God be the redeemer, that he might send us back to the wounded and tell us, you pay it forward. I put folk around you. You be there. You reach out. You hold them. You tell them the truth when they need to hear the truth. And we're bad about that in the church. We tell folk what we think they want to hear. But they can't heal from that mess. You got to love them enough to tell them the truth. And I'll tell you, I get this everywhere that I preach. I'm not that kind of preacher. Where people jump up and down and flip over benches. And stuff like that. Even though I love that kind of preaching myself personally. That's my thing. Running around the church. Amen. Well, it's true. I do. Running around church. I love that. That's my thing. But I've never been that kind of preacher. What God uses me for is to take you from one level to another. That is the whole crux of my ministry. And the anointing that God has placed on my life. And you need to know what God has placed on your life. And how it is that God uses you. So you don't find yourself trying to do one thing and God really wants your talents in another place doing something else. Because that's the place where he's going to bless you and not this other place. Let me finish with this story. I had a prison ministry years ago at a church that I was attending. And a group of us who had started singing together had then started a Bible study together. And that was that 5-hour Bible study. Yeah. We started a Bible study together, and out of that was birthed a prison ministry. And I went into the ministry, and we had three services. We had two men's services and a women's service. And the women's service was the last ministry. Now, you know, convicts, when they come into the auditorium or wherever it is you're holding the ministry, they don't always want to come to hear the preacher because they love Jesus. They're always real excited about the word of God when they say, yeah, I want to go to church today, I want to go to church. A lot of times it's because that's the place where they can connect. They can get together outside of the cells. It's a social place for them. So for the men, they packed it. I mean, both services. There was more men in there than there are in here. They packed both services. And we had a good time. And the Lord really did some marvelous things. But what stuck in my spirit was the women's service. And in the women's service, only four women showed up. Four. Three of them sat on the front row. And one in the second row. And I had one lady. She was sitting right where you are right now. And I'm preaching up a storm. I don't know what it was. But I was preaching up a storm. Word of God just, woo, boom. Same thing I had preached to the men. And she sat there the entire time. I kid you not, she was like this. mean mug it. I said, Lord, what is going on here? But I kept on preaching, and we got to the end of the service. She never changed. Expression never changed. She's still mad at the whole world. Mad at God. We got to altar call, and since there were four of us and four of them, it was really easy. I said, okay, well, I'm going to extend the altar call, and I want you guys, you know, if you feel like you really want to talk to the Lord about something, come on up here and let us talk to you. And in my mind, though, I'm going to be honest and transparent. In my mind, I'm going, Lord, don't, please don't send me this girl. Please. And she made a beeline for me. And I said, okay, God, okay. So I leaned down in her ear, and the other ones, their hands was up, and ooh, yeah. No, this one. And I leaned down and said, honey, what is it you want us to pray about? Is it something special, something particular? Nothing. She just, I said, okay. And I started a general prayer. And as I started that general prayer, the Holy Ghost picked it up. And he began to speak some things into her life. He taught, one of the things he taught, he said, I see your life like a ball of string, wound up tight, just layer upon layer of pain and disappointment and sorrow and defeat. But he told her, I am the Lord your God who will unravel every defeat in your life. I am the God who loves you, who will speak peace in the places where you have never had peace before. And I, as God began to talk to her, and I'm listening to God just as well as she is, I'm listening, I'm going, go, God, go. And next thing I know, because both our eyes are closed, next thing I know, I hear this. And God broke her right then. You better know who your enemy is. Know where your battlefield is. Be willing to fight the fight that God gives you. I'm going to ask that you would stand up, if you would. Amen. We must fight the fight that God gives us. We've got to fight the fight for your inheritance, fight the fight for your convictions, fight the fight for righteousness. Amen. If this is your fight, then don't allow anything to hinder the battle. Thank you, Lord. If this is your war, then the enemy can pour down misery until it falls like rain, but we'll fight. Amen. If this is our war, then fiery furnaces become our proving grounds. Thank you, Jesus. If this is our fight, use your faith like a shield and batter your enemy into subjection. You might say we are just men, not God. How can we do these things? You don't need to be God. Just have faith in God. Amen. And hold tightly to God. Yes. Just because he is God. Yes. You must need it more than you want it. Thank you. We're not peculiar people because we march to the beat of a different drummer. Although that's true, we are peculiar because we march to the heartbeat of God himself. Amen. We are more than conquerors. And I ask God, how can you be more than a conqueror? He said, you're an overcomer. Thank you, Jesus. It's one thing for me to fight and defeat my enemy by sheer strength, by sheer fortitude. But it's another thing that when my enemy comes against me, he finds nothing of his in me. And there is no fight. I could tell the story of my childhood without it breaking me up on the inside for one reason. I fought that fight. God told me, he said, baby, have you ever noticed you never talk to me and address me as father? And I said, really? He said, yes. I said, well, I didn't even realize. He said, but where I'm taking you, I need to be able to relate to you on that level. So we're going to have to address some issues in your life. Anybody been that wounded? You don't even want God to touch that thing. And God pulled me out of a hot service. I told you, flipping bitches, running around church. Yeah. Pulled me out of that one. And he says, let's deal with this now. And I said, God, what do you want? He said, I need you to be nothing. Now, if you guys know victims, if you know people who've been wounded, nothing is what they feel. And God told me, he said, baby, I need you to be nothing. I said, God, in tears, as much as I love you, I can't even do that for you. I can't be nothing, God. It'll destroy me. God said, if you'll trust me, honey, Bruce Reed, if you'll trust me, I promise you, I won't hurt you. If you'll trust me, I promise you, I won't hurt you. And I said, okay, God. And on my knees in the bathroom, because the kids were in the other room, I tell you, these are tears of joy. God fixed what one man had destroyed in my life. God fixed it. And I said, well, God, what do you want? What do you want me to do? How do I do this? He said, you need a substitute in your life that stands in for your father. I said, well, how do I do that? He said, you're at the place that you're at now because I want that pastor to be that man. And so I was in my 30s. I'm going to tell you all that now. I'm a little older than 30. I was in my 30s, and I said, I said, God, I'm a grown woman. I'm going to go to this man. Go talk to him. I've already prepared him. Go talk to him. And so I did. Me and Pastor and his wife, we sat down, and I told him the story I just told you. And by the end of the story, we were all in tears. And he said, honey, I would love to be your father. And during that time, and it wasn't long. It was over a summer that God did it. But during that time, my daughter got hit by a car on a major holiday. And while we were rushing to the hospital, I called Pastor and said, Pastor, I need you to come to the hospital. And he and his wife and the church, some other church people came and they rushed in. And they found the room where the family are, you know, that room. And he found me there by myself praying. And he came and he sat beside me. Now, for you all, that might not be a big thing. But you have to understand, that was not my experience with my father. He sat beside me, and he just touched my hand, and he began to pray. And I could feel the power of God that was in him, and the joy that he had, and the love of God that was on him began to seep into my hand. And it crept into my heart. And God said, don't worry, honey. This is going to work out okay. And I learned in 3 months, God healed what had wounded me for 30 years. I know we want to do wonderful and magnanimous things for the Lord. And God wants us to do those things, but not in spite of us. He wants us. We sang that song, what God has for me is for me. Well, that's the same with God. What is for God, what God has for himself is his. And that's us. And he wants us whole. He wants us completely delivered. He wants us healed to the point that when you tell the story, it's almost like you're talking about somebody else. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to get your sister's hand. We get used to leaning on preachers and leaders. Okay, I'm sorry. Let me fix this. I want you to get one sister's hand. Shoot. Two people. Get together. I want you all praying for each other. It could be three. Amen. But I want everybody to have a hand. Everybody has a hand. Everybody. Everybody got a hand? I want you to begin to speak into the life of your sister. She might have come into this place with a big smile on her face. You might have seen her with worshiping hands and dancing and bouncing, and she seems like she's got it all together, and on the inside, her world is falling apart. And she's too afraid to tell you she's in trouble. She's too ashamed to let you know, I'm struggling in this area. But if I let you know, you're not going to love me. You're not going to respect me anymore. So what I want us to do today is I want you to turn to your sister or your brother. And I want you to begin to pray into that life. I'm going to pray over you. But you all pray in turn. Turn to each other. And I want you to pray into one another. Amen. You ready? Praise God. The people in the back, they ready? Amen. Come on, let's start praying. Father God, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we bless and we praise you, Lord God. Thank you. Thank you for the word that you have given us on this day, Lord God. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord God, we bless you, Lord God, for what our ears have heard, Lord God, what our eyes have seen. Oh, we thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, for how you worked out things in our lives, Lord God. Oh, God, how you spoken into the dark places in our lives, oh God, and said, let there be light. Hallelujah. And there was light. Oh, God, how you unlocked the doors, Father God, that other people have locked on us, Lord God. And oh, thank you, Lord God, that every disease, every malady, Lord God, oh, that you have been the great physician for us, oh God, in the name of Jesus. All right now, Lord God, we claim the victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Not as conquerors, God. We claim the victory right now as overcomers. Hallelujah. In you, Lord God. Oh, let your love for us, Lord God, seep down into the deep places, Lord God. Ask God that you will cover this place, Lord God. Oh, let your blood flow, Lord God. Hallelujah. Begin to wipe out, Lord God, some places. Oh, that have inset sins, Lord God. Hallelujah. Oh, we thank you for honesty right now, God. Thank you, Lord God, that we're able to come before you, Lord God. Naked and unashamed, Lord God. Because you are the God who sits high and looks low. You are the God, oh God, who covers us, hallelujah, who covers us in our nakedness. You are the God who walks it out in our lives, Lord God. You are the one, Lord God, when we don't feel like we're going to take another step, you pick us up in your arms and say, come on, baby, let's keep on going. Oh, help us, God. Help us, Lord. Speak to us. Open our eyes that we might see ourselves the way that you see us, God. Oh, touch us, Lord God, right now. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall in this place, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, God. Yes, God. Hallelujah. God, we bless you. Oh, yes, we praise you. Oh, how sweet is the victory. Oh, that is won in you, Lord God. We thank you, God. For every pain, thank you, God. For every stripe, thank you, God. For every sorrow, thank you, God. For the fiery furnaces in our lives, Lord God. For you have used them, oh, hallelujah. Oh, to make us sons and daughters of you, Lord God. Sensitive and tender, Lord God. To the heart pain of others, Lord God. And so, Father God, as we come to you, as we come to you, God, as we come to you, God, hallelujah, as we come before you, God, hallelujah, we give you permission today to dismantle us, to dismantle everything in our lives, anything in our lives that if when shaken moves, take it out. Doesn't matter what it costs us, God, take it out. It doesn't matter how I feel about it, God, take it out. Doesn't matter what it looks like, God, take it out. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. As you finish up your prayers, we're going to open the altar here. As you finish up your prayers, we're going to open up the altar. I'm going to ask you to come. There's a power. Sometimes our fight is more than we can handle. And it takes us linking together with some other folk for God to be able to break those things in our lives. And you guys know. You know what I'm talking about. And so if you got one of those situations, we're going to ask that you will come. We're going to ask that you will come. Yeah, no, we're not interested in seeing you. We just want to be a part of what God's about to do for you. Is there one? Is there two? Is there three? Is there 10? No. No, 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 no. Something's missing. Something's not quite right. Something not quite right. I see tears of joy, tears of release, tears of deliverance. But there are hearts in here that are breaking from the inside out. There are tears that they can't push out. And so you don't think they need it, because you can't see it in them. And some folk need to get around them and pray for them. Do you understand what I'm saying? So you saints, if you feel God telling you, I don't know none of you, except two of you. If you feel God telling you, you go over there and pray with these women. You feel a release to go right now and begin to pray. There used to be a thing that we call praying folks through. When you don't stop praying, then something starts breaking. Till God gets finished with them. This is the last sermon that you're going to hear today. And all that has been preached before has brought you to right now. And right here. For you to confront that thing that has held you bound for years. For some of you, it's not even you. It's your heart connected to somebody else. And you need to bring that. You need to be, because you love them, you have legal access to their heart. You need to be that point of prayer for them. Let the saints cover around you and begin to speak into that one's life. You understand what I'm saying? So I'm going to tell you, just like Andre Crouch said, let the church be the church. Let's do the work of ministry today. You all do the work of ministry. I'm going to pray with these that have come up here. And I'm going to ask some of the preachers, if you guys will come, amen. We're not going to, those that have been working the altar, amen, don't work the altar. We're going to let the preachers come and pray for you, okay? Come and pray for you, because it's something to pour out and to minister into other folk. We don't always take the time to let folk pour in and minister unto us. Amen. So I'm going to ask the preachers, amen, those who have already spoken, amen, who are not engaged in some warfare, if you'll come here, amen, in the center, and let them come and preach, I'm sorry, and come to you, amen. Is that all right? I'm going to come down and leave the mic up here. Is this okay? Is this okay? Those of you all who are not going to pray up here, I need you to pray back there. The Bible tells us that one can set 1,000 to flight. to 10,000. We got some things in here that are going to need the collective efforts of the saints to break through. And this is their time. And this is that place. So I'm going to need you guys to pray. If you're not going to come up here, I want you to pray where you are. And begin to reach the heavens, amen, with your prayer. Those of you that God has already talked to and has delivered you, you need to begin to pray into the thing that he just delivered you from. Amen? Amen? So let's pray. Come on.